Being recorded. So, good afternoon, everyone. Just a quick check. If someone can let me know whether you can hear me, see me, and see my screen, that would be appreciated. Just a yes, please.
Yes.
All right.
Yes. Wonderful.
Good. Wonderful. So, welcome to this class. My name is Riccardo Bevilacqua. As you know, I'll be instructing for 24 hours or so the class on spacecraft attitude control via momentum exchange devices. I was really hoping to be in Naples and do this live. I actually had my ticket booked and everything, but everything is red now in Italy, so it's not happening this time around, but maybe in the future. So you see the first slide is the title of the course. We're talking about satellites, artificial satellites around this planet, at least for this class. And we want to control their attitude, which is not their behavior in a sense, but it's the orientation, how they are pointing in space, their sensors, for example, or whatever it is that they need to point to the ground, like a camera. We want to be able to steer their orientation in space using what are called momentum exchange devices, and we'll see what they are. So today is just an introduction. I want to go slow, and maybe I won't even be able to complete this overview in an hour, but you know, we'll continue tomorrow if we don't. You have my webpage there. It's my name, lastname.com. You find mostly, for those who are doing research in a similar field, you find my publications there. That's really the most important thing. And there's also some info about funded research that we're performing at the University of Florida, where I work. And ADAMUS stands for Advanced Autonomous Multiple Spacecraft, and that's the name of the lab I direct at the University of Florida. Since it's only a few of you, of course, feel free to stop me, you know, unmute yourself and ask questions at any time, okay? And then you have my email address, bevilr@ufl.edu, or just send me a message through Teams. Anything works. So what I was going to do is introduce myself and my research group real quick. I'll show you a couple of CubeSats, small spacecraft that we are putting together just as a way to introduce attitude control. I'll tell you how we are controlling, in particular, the orientation of those satellites. And then I have several slides that are an overview of attitude determination and control systems. From now on, we'll call them ADCS. You may find the acronym ADACS, which is simply attitude determination and attitude control system. And you know, attitude is everything. If you've taken astrodynamics classes, you know, usually we study the satellites as point masses, and we just care about their trajectories. But the reality is that if we are not able to control their orientation in space, for 99.99% of the missions, you've lost the mission, because unless you just have a tumbler, an experiment that doesn't require you to stabilize orientation or point a certain device to a target, which is very rare these days, you're not really performing anything. You're just flying a piece of junk in space that is not able to complete the mission, okay? So we will now focus on the determination component, which means measuring how you are pointing in space, in three-dimensional space. We'll focus on the control part only with some specific systems. And so the control of this the focus of this class will be control. And by the end of this introductory lecture, I would like everybody to kind of know what a momentum exchange device is. And I'll show you a simulating example, which is actually your final deliverable for this class. Now, as you will see, I'll show you the syllabus. I don't really have a criteria for grading your two homeworks, which is basically two simulating assignments. I just want you guys to learn, in particular to learn Simulink if you've never used it before, and to be able to translate some of the equations, most of the equations that we see in this class, into an actual simulation. That's really the goal. So you're all graduate students. My goal is not, you know, giving you a low grade or be super strict on that. I just need you to learn, and I'm sure that you're at that point in life where you want to learn. For your own sake. So can you actually see, probably not, right, the video?
Yes.
Oh, you do. You see this guy with the bicycle wheel, right?
Yes.
And so you probably have seen this before. He's sitting on a chair that, you know, can swivel, and then someone will give a certain angular momentum or, you know, spin rate to the wheel, and then he starts applying a torque to change the rotation axis of the wheel. It does, and in response, he starts turning in a certain direction. And then that's the principle of, for example, a control moment gyro. So inside certain types of spacecraft, you have spinning wheels that are actually kept at a constant spin rate. So there is actuators at the axis that maintain, say, 500,000 RPM, rotations per minute. And then you change the direction of what we call the gimbal, which is the axis of rotation, through another system of actuators. And you, the guy sitting on the chair, will be the spacecraft, and you can change your orientation. And imagine you can have multiple of these devices on board, and that's a control moment gyro, just to give you an example. So momentum exchange devices, they do exactly that. They exchange momentum from an actuator to the spacecraft. The reason why this gentleman is rotating is because the entire angular momentum of a spacecraft slash person and control moment gyro slash the bicycle wheel has to be constant, unless, you know, there's something else acting on them from the outside. But assuming that this is an isolated system in space, which will be in actual orbit, then to maintain the constant angular momentum of the entire system, of the two of them, they need to exchange momentum. And since you're trying to change the angular momentum of the bicycle wheel, well, something else will have to change to keep a vector. We'll see what that means. But something else will have to change to maintain the same angular momentum of the two of them together, and that's why the person is spinning. Okay, so that's the principle of reaction wheels, control moment gyros, variable speed control moment gyros, anything that exchanges momentum. I hope that's, you know, should be pretty much self-explanatory with that video. So, introductions, as I said. I'm assuming you're all PhD students in two different programs, as far as I can tell, the aerospace one and the cosmology one. But myself, I got my degrees in Italy as well, a Master of Science in Aerospace Engineering in Rome. And then I went to Grupo Mecánica del Vuelo in Spain for a year, learned some Spanish. I still practice some Spanish with students from Colombia in this particular phase of life. We have an agreement with University of Bogota, and then I went back to Italy for a PhD in applied math, but I still worked on aerospace problems. Became a postdoc in California for 3 years. Then I was upstate New York, RPI's Rensselaer Polytechnic Institute, and I've been at UF since 2014. I wrote a thesis, the master thesis, also of particular interest for you guys. Because, and it's among the files that I share with you. Can you see this PDF?
Yes.
So it's in Italian, so it may be helpful. But basically, this thesis is about controlling a satellite using VSCMGs, which are variable speed control moment gyros. In reality, what you will see in actual spacecraft is either reaction wheels or control moment gyros. But this is a concept that has been out there for a while, where the bicycle wheel can actually change the spin rate. I don't think they've ever been used in space, but it's still an interesting concept. And I think it helps the learning process to actually model the most general system you can think of. So at the end of this class, hopefully you'll be actually able to implement some of the equations that are in this thesis. But, you know, you're more than welcome to use it as a reference. Some of the equations that I will use are actually based on similar nomenclature. You'll see this image again. And so that's, you know, that's something interesting, hopefully, for you to read. And this was a long time ago, about almost 20 years ago. So I have a research group in the Adamus lab, and at any given time, several, you know, two, three, up to five, sometimes PhD students. Some master students, we use the undergraduate students as well. We use their help in our research projects. So it's a pretty interesting environment. Right now, we have more than 10 undergraduate students as we're putting together two CubeSats. And I have some logos here of funding agencies. You know, that's the nature of the business. I have to pay these guys. So what we do, which is really what interests you, and may, in case you know you want to find a place for an exchange program in the future, we focus on GNC for multi-spacecraft systems for the most part. It's also for single satellites, but really formation flying is been my bread and butter for a long time. And my students develop first and foremost theory. So we focus on developing, say, a new way to guide to spacecraft to rendezvous with each other using atmospheric differential drag. You'll find a lot of papers on that topic on my website, for example. And then only in a few occasions, some of these algorithms that we develop can be tested with what we call spacecraft simulators. So we have robotic units that moving on a flat floor, the same one you've seen in the previous picture, this black floor on which we're standing. So this is an epoxy floor, very smooth and horizontal, on which we operate units that float virtually without any friction using air bearings. So you turn on the air bearings at the bottom of these robots, and they can move on the floor almost without any friction. And then using compressed air thrusters, they can be controlled. And so in some cases, we've been able to validate the algorithms with these spacecraft simulators. Of course, these algorithms have to deal with the fact that we only have thrusters, so they need to be targeted to a system that can only control, you know, orientation and position using thrusters, for example. And I've used it actually for a class similar to this one. At the end of that class, the students will have a Simulink model that they translate into C code and deploy on the PC-104 on board the vehicle that you see here, and actually change orientation and control orientation of the spacecraft simulator, which is really, really exciting. Because if you look down here, I don't know if you can see my mouse, but there is a spherical air bearing at the top of this pedestal. And so we can also just turn that one on and simulate attitude motion only. So maybe some of you will come and see this live. And then in even less cases, we've been actually able to secure funding to build spacecraft that implement some of our ideas. And mostly it's been CubeSats. Actually, all of them have been CubeSats. For those who are not familiar with the CubeSat format, one unit cube is a 10 by 10 by 10 centimeter cube. So they're very tiny boxes, and you can grow them in size, and you can have a 2U, which is a 10 by 10 by 20, 10 by 10 by 30 is a 3U, etc. So that's what we're working on. And so let's talk about these CubeSats a little bit, just because, you know, we're going to soon switch to talking about attitude control. So there was one that I designed and partially built with my students when I was at RPI called PADOS, Propellantless Atmospheric Differential Drag Low Earth Orbit Spacecraft. We really have a thing for acronyms, myself and my students. But anyways, this is, it was never completed because the funding was to acquire the hardware, but there was no launch secured. So we still have a lot of this hardware, but we're not using it these days. But it was a 3U CubeSat. Actually, let me get that back. It's three, including everything. That, as you can see, in the back end has this origami deployable retractable drag sail. So the idea was being able to increase and decrease the drag resistance that this object would experience in low Earth orbit, where there is still some residual atmosphere. And then solar panels, all the subsystems you can think of, but really I want to focus on, for example, one of them, the Blue Canyon Technology ADAX. It's right before the sail. This is a half U, completely enclosed attitude determination and attitude control system. So what that does, you buy it off the shelf. It's very expensive. It's more than $100,000. And it has the opening that you see that it's looking at us. It's actually a star tracker. So it's a you can say it's a camera. It's a system that can look at the stars. And there is software on board that can recognize the patterns of the stars that you're looking at, so that you can reconstruct which way in space you're pointing, at which constellation you're pointing with that face of the satellite, for example. So it has a star tracker, and inside, believe it or not, there are three momentum exchange devices, very tiny reaction wheels. what a reaction wheel is, well, go back to the video of the CMG and imagine that you cannot do the exercise of changing the direction of the wheel with your hands. That spin axis is fixed, but what you can do is spin up the wheel, accelerate its rotation or decelerate that rotation. Still, the principle is the same. If you are augmenting or diminishing the angular momentum of something that is part of your system, something else has to happen on the entire system to compensate for it. So they're just simpler. They only change the spin rate, but they are also momentum exchange devices. So this is one of the spacecraft we designed in the past, and we acquired this subsystem commercial off the shelf. We didn't develop anything. Another one called D3 drag the orbit device. This is now under assembly, and we have to give it to NASA in August. It will be going to the International Space Station through one of the SpaceX resupply missions, hopefully in November. And then once it's there, it's inside what it's called the NanoRacks deployers. It's a company. NanoRacks is a private company that works with NASA. They put you inside these deployers, and basically the astronauts receive these containers full of CubeSats. And when they have time in their busy schedules, they just kick you out. They connect these deployers to the port that it's in the aft part of the International Space Station. And you can find videos online of these tiny CubeSats shoeboxes that are ejected, jettisoned from the International Space Station. It's pretty cool. So we have two CubeSats that have to be delivered this year. This is one. And you see in the top left image, you can recognize the white is the 2U CubeSat. It's a little box that has four deployable, very long surfaces in the back. They can reach almost 4 meters in length. And this to the right is a zoomed in image of the system that deploys those surfaces. They are basically like measuring tape, motorized, so you can extract the surface and retract the surface. And again, it's the concept of augmenting, diminishing the drag force that this vehicle will experience. They are in a DART configuration, as you can see. So what this system is designed to do is to control the reentry of the CubeSat. So you're deployed from the International Space Station, and then you need to come down within 25 years. NASA imposes this restriction for low Earth orbit satellites. And we want to control when the location of when it starts burning into the atmosphere. Say at 120 kilometers, we want this object to be at a specific longitude and latitude with a certain accuracy. And so this system and the algorithms that go with it is designed to realize this kind of mission. Now, for our purposes, what are the observations to make in terms of attitude control? But there are several for these particular CubeSats. We do not have any momentum exchange devices here, but we have other things. We have these copper lines that you see in the right top image. They're wires. There is actually copper wires. And they are creating what it's called a magnet torquers. So in other words, you run current through those loops. And by running current through a loop, as you may know from physics, you create a magnetic dipole. So you artificially create a magnetic field kind of vector on your spacecraft that is going to couple with the natural magnetic field of the Earth. And in turn, you cross product the two, you cross multiply the two, and you get a torque. And so that's a way to maneuver the orientation of a spacecraft. It's a very cheap way, very non-accurate way, but it is another way to control attitude, which is not the focus of this class, but it's important to know, especially, you know, if we want to give a good overview of spacecraft attitude in general. So that's another way to kind of a semi-passive way to control orientation. And then notice, as I said before, that the four surfaces are deployed at an angle in the back. I call that a dart configuration because it's like a dart. So what happens is that this spacecraft will fly with the front of it, the part that is not mounting this drag device, hopefully parallel or perpendicular rather that face to the velocity vector. And the fact that there is atmosphere should stabilize that orientation. So the spacecraft should naturally want to fly with the long axis of the 2U kind of parallel to the velocity vector, because you have a central pressure that is behind the central mass of the CubeSat, and the central pressure is generated It's moved behind by you deploying those surfaces in the back at an angle. Okay, so here we have magnetic torque to control the orientation, and also aerodynamic torque. As we will learn in space, we call torques sometimes disturbances, especially the ones that come from the environment, and sometimes we actually use them. So in space, resources are limited, and we do our best to use what is available. And at the bottom, you just see some images of, the CubeSat without the solar panels. Actually, it's this vehicle is enclosed by solar panels, and it's not so empty, but this is a few renderings to show you the main subsystems. And then finally, we have another one. So these are just the top ones are just other images of the Drag the Orbit device. It was featured on Aerospace America. There's a video that I'll show you maybe some other time about one of these deployers extracting and retracting the surface. It's really just a motorized measuring tape. And then the last CubeSat that we actually have to deliver in May, we'll see if we can do that. It's called PATCOOL, the Passive Thermal Quoting Observatory operating in low Earth orbit. And this time the acronym is not just my fault, it's also NASA's fault. So now this one is a 3U. And it doesn't have any deployables, really. So the way it looks like in this rendering that you see, the second image from the left, it's exactly how it looks like. There's almost nothing deploying from it other than a small magnetometer that is, a one-time little arm that deploys on one side. But it doesn't have surfaces that come out. It doesn't have anything else. The top of it, you can see these four openings. Under the openings, there are four coin-shaped metallic samples. Two are painted with state-of-the-art coatings that NASA is using to isolate thermally metallic, tanks and containers in space. And the other two are coated with something that they want to test, something new that they have developed that they claim can actually reach cryogenic temperatures and keep them even in the sun. So it's a better coating for thermal isolation. So we had to design the CubeSat. We're buying also another commercial off-the-shelf attitude determination and control system that has magnetorquers, reaction wheels, and not star trackers, but it has sun sensors. So they can sense where the sun is, and that way you orient yourself. And this satellite has to point with those four openings always away from the planet. So the attitude requirement in this case is that the satellite has to have the long axis pointing away from the planet. So this is what we're doing. And we already talked about orientation. In the first CubeSat, this, as you can imagine, had to fly similarly to the Drag the Orbit device with this sail that is always as much as possible normal to the velocity vector. Same for this unit. While in this case, we want the long axis, instead of flying parallel to the velocity vector, in this case, it actually has to be normal to the velocity vector on its orbit. If you're not familiar with what an orbit is, we'll also review that information later on. Bottom line is that the long axis, instead of flying, parallel to the ground, is actually normal to the ground at all times. So different requirements. Okay, let's talk about more expensive birds. That's another expression for satellites. So this is a very much bigger satellite. It's a commercial imaging satellite. It's just an example that you can find online. But just to have an idea of what you will see when you say that you're going to work in this field and you need to design a controlled system or an attitude determination system. So this one is a satellite that has a camera that needs to look down, and it has to cover 16.4 kilometers in nadir. That's what is basically how wide, if you're looking down from the satellite to the planet, how wide you need to be and able to take, how much you have to cover left and right, if you like, to take images. So 16.4. The system is controlled on three axes. Some missions may not require that you control every axis of the satellite, but in this case you do. And it is mounting control moment gyros. So it is mounting the bicycle wheels that we've seen before, just a little more expensive than a bicycle wheel. And it senses how it's pointing, because really you can't control something unless you know where it is, using a combination of star trackers and a solid state. This is basically an inertial unit. For our purposes, what we care about is that the star trackers will measure the orientation, which way you're pointing, and the IRU is measuring the angular velocity, how quickly you're changing orientation. And then another requirement that is important to know in this case is that how quickly he has to be able to change orientation. He needs to be able to reach angular accelerations of 1.5 degrees per second squared, maximum rate of 3.5, and it has to be able to slew 300 kilometers in 9 seconds. So if it's looking at a certain city, say it's looking at Naples, it's flying over Italy, well, is Rome 300 kilometers away? It's probably less, but let's say, you know, let's say that Rome and Naples are 300 kilometers away. Well, in 9 seconds, he has to be able to orient itself and point at Rome on its given orbit. And by the way, the orbit is, you see it here, orbit altitude is 770 kilometers. So it's not that high. It's really at the edge of the atmosphere, a little higher. So it's really not coming down because of the drag, but it's still a pretty low orbit, which means that the change in angle, it's quite important, even if you have to go from, you know, pointing Naples to Rome. The closer you are to the surface, as you can imagine, the more you have to reorient your spacecraft to change target, okay? And so there's a lot of other information here that you're more than, you know, welcome to read, but this is an example of, you know, requirements, where you see the agility acceleration on a spacecraft and the systems that you need to choose. Basically, you're first given the requirements. This satellite has to, you know, be able to do something like this, slew 300 kilometers in 9 seconds, and then you choose what kind of systems you need to mount on it or design for it in order to be able to satisfy those requirements. Okay, so what are we going to do in this class? We're going to look at mostly rigid body mechanics, which is kinematics and dynamics of attitude. Now, the reality is that when you look at an entire spacecraft, the fact that we deal with the particle, you know, the center of mass on its given trajectory, and then separately is we deal with what we're doing here, orientation, it's really an abuse of what reality is, because these two problems are connected. For example, in this sketch, you see that the orbital dynamics, where you are on your orbit, will definitely affect the disturbance torques. Very simple examples. If you are in low Earth orbit, there is atmosphere, the drag force, depending on the shape of your satellite, will act on you in different ways, and it can create torques. If you're not in low Earth orbit and you are, say, 1,000 kilometers or above, there's no drag, there's no atmosphere, so that torque is gone. Maybe there's something else, the solar radiation pressure, if you have reflective surfaces, and so on and so forth. And vice versa, if you have different shapes of orientations of your spacecraft, you have different drag forces. Imagine that you have a very flat satellite, and if you fly it with this smallest surface against the upcoming particles in LEO, then your drag force is minimal. And so your orbital perturbation, the force that is slowing you down, actually speeding you up, but it's bringing you down into the atmosphere, is minimal. If you change orientation, which is part of what we do in the highlighted, red area here, if you change orientation, you increase the drag, and then you're going to affect the orbital perturbation that is the drag force. And so the two are definitely going together. But we'll focus more on what is on the right side, and in particular on RWs, reaction wheels, CMGs. And I think if we had time, I would still like to talk about other torques that are part of nature, because, you know, that's part of the dynamics of a spacecraft. All right, so in order to understand really what are the implications of working in this field and choosing an ADCS or designing your own, for example, sizing up the reaction wheels that you decide to mount on your spacecraft, or just you're putting together a CubeSat, you're designing it, and you decide that you want to buy the ADCS already made for you, well, you still have to, choose carefully how much power it draws, what kind of torque it can give you, and so on and so forth. So this nice image, this comes, you'll see a lot of these images coming from a textbook from Hughes, so I just stole them from there. This nice matrix shows you on the diagonal the different subsystems. And for each subsystem, if you are on the roll, you have basically incoming requirements that affect your choice. So in other words, we're focusing on ADCS here. The choice of ADCS would be affected by the spin requirement here, for example. Some satellites are stabilized by maintaining a rotation about an axis. And so depending on how quickly you want to do that, well, you have a certain requirement on how powerful you need the ADCS. Pointing requirements, these PNTGs, pointing requirements. Go back to that previous satellite that I showed you, the one that has to slew in nine seconds. Well, that has probably very strict pointing requirements. I don't know if it was listed. Let me go back. Well, it has a sensor resolution, but it doesn't tell you how accurate you need to be. Oh, well, GPS position, accuracy, and knowledge. It doesn't seem like it's here, but basically how accurate you need to be in terms of pointing in a certain location definitely affects how you choose the ADCS. I'll tell you right away that you can't get away with a magnet worker if you have strict requirements to point within a degree of accuracy in a certain direction. So all these requirements affect your choice. But then once you choose your ADCS, you're going to affect other things. You're going to affect your power profile. If you choose something that is very power hungry, then you know you may not have enough power, and the EPS, the electrical power system, has to be changed. And then let's see, the volume. Of course, this is a physical system. You have to put it somewhere. So as you can imagine, every subsystem is affecting the other ones. And so it's very important that we find a compromise. Designing a vehicle and a spacecraft as well is never optimal in any of the subsystems. It's always suboptimal in all of these subsystems, but it's a compromise that works. And so the ADCS is affected by several things and will affect a lot of other things, of course. So let's start talking about attitude a little bit more specifically. What are the phases? So if you have a satellite, an artificial satellite, man-made vehicle that goes to space, there are modes of operation that are usually recognizable. First of all, you have to be inserted into your orbit. A launcher will put you up. In our case, our two CubeSats will actually first go to the International Space Station. So you are already orbiting the same way the ISS is once you're there. It's just that then they kick you out and you have a delta V, different velocity, but you're pretty much in the same orbit of the ISS. So there are different ways to be inserted into orbit. And usually when you are inserted into orbit, your spacecraft is actually completely off. There's really nothing going on. If you're ejected by a rocket while it's on its ascent, then maybe the rocket itself is stabilized and it's spinning, but you're not. And actually, for deployment from the International Space Station, there are strict requirements, and I believe you can't turn on anything for 30 minutes after you're deployed for safety reasons. They don't want you to do anything, and they want you to separate yourself with your satellite from the ISS before you do anything. And then after, you see there is a stabilization phase. So no matter how precise the system that puts you out into orbit, into space is, there are going to be some disturbances. So in the case of the International Space Station, these CubeSats are pushed out by a spring mechanism. And it's a linear spring. So you would say, well, you know, it's not going to impart any torques, but you know, there are imperfections always. And so there is what we call a tumbling motion that it's assumed to exist every time a satellite is deployed from whatever it's coming from. Tumbling means that there is a three-axis rotation, so the angular velocity of your object, if you consider it as a rigid body, is projected on all three axes of the satellite, and so you need to actually slow that down. And so that is the stabilization phase. And the magnet orcas that I showed you for one of our missions, they are mostly used for that phase. They are not difficult to design, and what they do is that they exploit the magnetic field to only kill basically the angular velocity. So the goal of that phase is only to reduce omega. We'll call it omega from now on. and you don't care about which way necessarily you're pointing, you only detumble, you only reduce the angular velocity to prepare yourself to do what you need to do. And then you have the normal on station, so now you acquire your design orientation, and maybe that's all you need to do, you maintain that one. For example, for our PathCool mission, our desired orientation is with the long axis radially away from the planet, but we also have to slowly rotate about that axis to point the solar panels on one side to the sun, and that's that our normal operation, but we don't really do any slewing. Slewing is more for, you know, agile spacecraft that have cameras to point. And then you may have contingency plans. Maybe your power is not enough to use your reaction wheels when you are in eclipse. Maybe your power budget doesn't allow you. And so when you don't see the sun on your panels, you can't recharge the batteries, maybe you just shut off or put in attitude determination and control system. So, and these are all things that you have to keep into account when you design your mission. And then you may have special requirements, again, eclipse, or you're pointing at something. And definitely the military applications, you know, when you're taking images, acquisition of targets and tracking targets on the ground are the ones that are usually the most demanding. Okay, so these are the faces. What are the actuators that you can find on a satellite? The most typical ones. Well, in this table, you see in white what we call attitude passive stabilization means. So they are basically, there's not much intelligence behind these ones. In other words, there's no complicated control algorithms that process information and decide, okay, apply this torque on this axis, accelerate these reaction wheels in such a way, or control the gimbal rate of your contra-moment gyro. So there's nothing behind these systems like that. The gravity gradient is simply the fact that parts of your spacecraft that are closer to the planet are going to be attracted more intensively than those that are farther away. And so you're gonna end up behaving like a pendulum if you have a very elongated, you know, structure. And that's exploited to basically point down one face of the spacecraft, pointed at the ground. And as you can see, it's a very limited way to control orientation. It's very inaccurate, 5 degrees or so, but it's free. So what people do usually, they have what they call gravity gradient booms. So they deploy a tip mass attached to a cable and change the distribution of mass of the satellite so that you can behave more and more like a pendulum. It's free, it's inaccurate. Passive magnetic stabilization, maybe you have a magnet on board your satellite or you turn on your coils and you keep them at a constant current. Well, that will definitely try to align your dipole with the magnetic field of the Earth. But, you know, it's just usually it can only allow you to point north or south and kind of the same accuracy as gravity gradient. And it's really, I mean, we call it passive. I call it passive mostly because, again, there's not much logic behind this, but you actually are actively running current through a wire in this case. Pure stabilization. You deploy your spacecraft and you do it by giving it an angular rate about one axis. And that's it. So that's imposed at the beginning of the mission. And the only goal is that axis about which you're spinning is going to be pointing in inertial space, always pretty much in the same direction. It's just a way to give more rigidity to your to that axis. If you go back to the video of the spinning wheel, the faster you spin that wheel, the harder it's going to be to change its spin axis direction. So that's the same principle, pure spin stabilization. Dual spin is just the same concept. It's just now one piece of the spacecraft is spinning, the other one is not. And then in yellow, you have a little more active type of control. The gravity gradient and momentum bias wheel, it's a combination of gravity gradient and a wheel inside the spacecraft that is spinning at a certain rate. And then you have all these other ones like thrusters, which, you know, are now firing engines and expelling gases from the spacecraft. They can give you very fast maneuvers. They can give very fine accuracy. They require propellant, so it's limited. Then you have what we call CMGs or reaction wheels. They're called zero momentum actuators. They can be a lot more accurate than thrusters. Thrusters at some point reach what we call a limiting cycle, because usually you fire them and they can give you one value of force or torque, and you can pulse them, you can do whatever you want, but they cannot really, at some point you reach a point where you just oscillate back and forth about your target that you're pointing. While with reaction wheels or CMGs, you have a more continuous actuator. You can finely tune them, you can finely change their spin rates, etc. And as you can see here, you have accuracies that are incredible, 0.001 degrees or even less. And so, but they are more expensive in terms of the hardware itself, in terms of the fact that they require, in the first case of thrusters, propellant, and that can finish, but also for the other ones, they require electrical power. Just a few images explaining the previous table. The first one, believe me, is not a grenade. It's actually coming from the same book. It's, for some reason, they represented a spin-stabilized spacecraft as a ball with one axis that is preferred. So it's just spinning about that axis. Dual spinning stabilization is just that now, imagine in this system, it's the bottom is spinning, but the top that is mounting antenna, we can't allow it to spin at high rate because it's maybe looking down at the planet. So that's why we separate the spinning part from the non-spinning part. Momentum bias stabilization, nothing more than just, again, a spinning object. Instead, it's inside now. It's a wheel that is inside that it's spinning, so that the outside, the actual spacecraft, is not spinning at all. Where are reaction wheels used? What is a reaction wheel? It's a spinning wheel, but we can control its spin rate. Well, you find them in pretty famous spacecraft like the Hubble Space Telescope, for example. Reaction wheels and control moment gyros instead are for more, you know, tracking and accurate satellites like the one that we've seen before. And then CMGs combined with some gravity gradient, used, for example, was used on the space shuttle, was exploited on the space shuttle, and it's used on the International Space Station. As you can imagine, the ISS is pretty big, and there's definitely parts that are closer to the planet than others, and that creates a gravity gradient torque. Now, the actual ADCS in practice, no matter what it is, really more or less complicated, as long as there is a measurement and you reacting to that measurement, it's made of course, a hardware component and a software component. The hardware is pretty easy. It's your spacecraft. So in Simulink, we will simulate the spacecraft, what we call the spacecraft dynamics. In reality, you don't have differential equations, you have the actual vehicle. And that vehicle is mounting sensors. For the most part, we have attitude sensors. So those are star trackers, sun sensors. We'll see them in a few slides. They are devices that can tell you your position in terms of orientation. Always make this parallel in your mind. It's a good exercise. If you think about a point mass, the position can be represented by X, Y, Z, okay? Well, the same for attitude. We'll see different ways. One is other angles, or another one is quaternions, but basically there are devices that can measure your X, Y, Z in terms of orientation. In this case, it will not be X, Y, Z, it will be angles, for example, but the attitude sensors measure the angles. The rate sensors measure the rate of those angles, so how quickly they're changing, angular velocity, omega. So in real life, you will have the spacecraft, some ways to measure what it's doing, and a way to actuate on the spacecraft or the actuators, which we have just seen. Passive, semi-passive, very active, power-consuming, propellant-consuming, you name it, but there is a way for you to do something and change the orientation of the spacecraft. But behind all this, there must be some logic. So in our class, we'll develop a logic that only deals with the actuators, in particular momentum exchange devices, but really what's on the flight computer is a attitude determination algorithm. Usually it's extended Kalman filters. Basically there's some software that can process the information from the sensors, clean them up, remove noise, combine them in such a way that you have a reasonable and usable estimate of which way you're pointing and how quickly you're moving. And then there is a control law that decides in response to what you're doing and where you need to be, pointing how to operate the actuators. Okay, and so in Simulink, as I said, we'll deal with the actuators control laws, and we'll definitely simulate the spacecraft dynamics. Again, this is an overview, more tables. I won't spend too much time on this one. These are the environmental torques. This is what we usually don't like because they are disturbances. But before I said the gravity gradient was actually exploited, you know, it is exploited. If you know that you've designed your spacecraft to use the gravity gradient intelligently. But unfortunately, if that was not your goal or you cannot do that, and you still have a pretty elongated spacecraft over a big structure, you're still going to experience gravity gradient because of its distribution of mass, and it's there. Solar radiation pressure, you really don't feel that much in LEO because there is the magnetic field of the Earth, which is shielding us, and drag is definitely more important, but it's still there. The magnetic field itself, it's a disturbance. If we're flying around this planet that has a magnetic field, no matter what you do on your spacecraft, even if you don't have magnet torquers, you don't have those wires and you don't intentionally run current through those wires, you still have a residual dipole on board because you have electronics on board and they do create some parasitic, you know, there are some currents. And so they create a parasitic dipole, if you like. There are textbooks that give you rule of thumb to estimate what is your residual dipole. But the bottom line is that you still have a little bit of torque from that. And then the aerodynamic, obviously, if you are in LEO. Now, keep in mind that these torques can be really small. I mean, you may be looking at numbers that are 10 to the minus 6 Newton meters. And you may be tempted to think, that's nothing. I don't even have to take that into account. Well, but you are orbiting and you're flying, you know, if you are on the orbit of the ISS, one orbit is 90 minutes. And you go over several orbits in a day. And a torque that is constantly acting, maybe on the same axis with the same sign at all times, it definitely accumulates. And you may end up in half a day pointing in a completely different direction because you didn't take into account of that tiny torque. So they are important. But there are also other disturbances that you unfortunately have to deal with because we're not perfect. We design our spacecraft and we mount thrusters on the spacecraft. And when we fire those thrusters, they're the force that they generate will never be perfectly aligned as we wanted. So that creates a torque. If you have, you know, location of the center of gravity of your spacecraft is slightly different than what you estimated in the CAD, because it's always the case. You can't model everything. You can try, but the wires are wires, and they may be moving around when you are actually shaking in the launcher that is going up. And so there are things that we cannot really account for perfectly, and they're there. Liquid sloshing, of course. Flexible appendages that you deploy, like antennas, like the drag the orbit device. We modeled it, but in reality, it's not going to do exactly what we modeled. If you have rotating components on board, of course, they're like momentum exchange devices. They affect your behavior. So these are all things that you can model as much as you want, but they're probably not going to be captured entirely. Finally, another bit of overview of all the systems we have on board. We talked about actuators a lot, thrusters, reaction wheels. See, this is an image that represents a reaction wheel. You see this is the ground. This will be your spacecraft. And you see the only thing you can do is change the rotational rate of this wheel. For control moment gyros instead, you see the wheel itself is spinning at a fixed rate, and what is grounded is the gimbal. So now we can control the orientation of the spin axis of this wheel. Magnet torquers, you run current through a wire. We haven't talked much about sensors. We said that we can measure the sun. We can measure position of stars. We can also measure the position of the horizon, basically the horizon, you know, separation between the Earth and deep space. We have gyroscopes that can measure angular velocity. Accelerometers are really not that important for us. There are also dampers that you can find on board spacecraft. We're not going to focus on those. And of course, computers and processors, etc. So a few more words on this overview about sensors. We have 10 minutes left. All you need to know for this class, you're more than welcome to dig more into the details of this, but sun sensors are only two-dimensional. So if you want to know your three-dimensional orientation in space, you need more than one, because they basically tell you where the sun is. They tell you the position of the sun with respect to you. They measure the vector of the sun from your center of mass of the spacecraft, and that's not enough. You can't leave with just, you can't reconstruct the orientation with just one vector. Star sensors instead can measure more than one vector, because they look at multiple stars, and they can reconstruct your 3D orientation in space. Horizon sensors, same story, they measure one vector, and so you need at least two to reconstruct the 3D. Otherwise, you have only a partial information of orientation. And gyroscopes, there are mechanical ones. These days, we use fiber optic gyroscopes that are more accurate. They don't have moving parts, and basically, they tell you the angular velocity of your satellites. And accelerometers measure linear accelerations. We don't really care about those for this class. Now, I could continue with these images, but I think all you need to take away from this last collection of tables is that, you know, the actuators can have different ranges. And for what we are concerned, really, we are looking at reaction wheels and contra moment gyros. And then you're more than welcome to read the other ones. But the typical range for reaction wheels is that they give you torques that are very tiny, like the ones you find on CubeSats, the systems that we buy, you know, fractions of Newton meters. Down here, the 0.01 Newton meters to 1 Newton meter. So they don't give you huge torques, usually, and they can spin in the order of a few thousands of RPM. These days, the tiny ones that you find on CubeSats, they can probably go up to 10,000 RPM. The torques are still pretty small. But they're very simple to control because it's just a wheel, and all you do is you spin it up or slow it down. That's all. Contramoment gyros, instead, can give you a lot more torque. As you see here, they're usually in a range of 25 to 500 Newton meters. And this information may be even outdated because, you know, technology advances. But they usually weigh less, as you can see the last two columns of this matrix. They weigh less, and they take usually a little less power. It's an effect of CMGs that we will see that is called torque amplification. So there is an advantage of having a wheel and just changing the spin axis rather than spinning up or down that wheel. So they have several advantages. The disadvantage is that there's more moving parts. So there's more points for potential failure when you use this. So after having drank from this fire hose of actuators and sensors, etc., well, let's, you know, start talking about these momentum exchange devices and give a quick introduction. What we will do, and then I'll stop in a few minutes because we're almost reaching the hour mark. For our purposes, we will have usually three main reference coordinate systems or reference frames. They're two different things, but let's call them coordinate systems for now. One that is a coordinate system attached to the inertial observer, the red one. We will have this potato, which is our spacecraft, the green one, that is flying around the planet, that may be sitting at the center of this inertial red coordinate system. And it has its own axis attached to it that we define. We call B1, B2, B3 as body. So those are the axes of the spacecraft that we use as reference to measure where the different parts of the spacecraft are located with respect to usually its own central mass, okay? And then we may have these, what we call assemblies or momentum exchange devices that in the most general sense are disks. They can spin up, speed down, but also can change the orientation of the spin axis. In the most general sense, we can say that we have variable speed contra moment gyros. And then as you lock some degrees of freedom, you can have a CMG or a reaction wheel. But in general, they can do that. They can change spin rate and they can change orientation of the spin axis. And so these assemblies of the momentum exchange devices also will have their own coordinate system that I'm calling here S, T, and J, or AS, AT, AJ, with the AG, I'm sorry, with the J representing the jth momentum exchange device, assuming that we have multiple of these on board. And so what we have is that S will be the direction of the spin axis, the direction of, it's basically the symmetry axis of that disk. And then the gimbal axis, if the disk can be changed orientation, that will be the axis on which the gentleman of the bicycle wheel, the axis that he was manipulating, okay, by applying a torque about the t-axis, the tangential one. Okay, so that's the gimbal axis and this is the tangential axis. So we have three coordinate system. The inertial one, you are sitting on it, usually. You are the person operating the spacecraft from the ground, so you deal with this red coordinate system. The spacecraft has to deal with its own coordinate system, the green one, and but also the control laws that we'll see will have to deal with these assemblies that are inside the spacecraft that they can move with respect to the spacecraft. So the spacecraft moves with respect to us, the inertial observer, the momentum exchange devices move inside the spacecraft to control it, okay? So let's continue. Little bit of nomenclature here. This is just an intro, of course. We will call, when we get to derive the equations of motion, and it will take a while for the spacecraft itself mounting the all these objects inside that can do different things, we will call J the matrix of inertia of the spacecraft in its principal axis, plus contributions from all these different assemblies. And I invite all of you to look carefully at this terminology and let me know next time or via email before we meet tomorrow whether anything that I'm saying makes sense, because there are some things that I need to give for granted, or at least you should know what they are. For example, what is the matrix of inertia of a rigid object and what are the principal axes of inertia? I mean, we'll refresh that, but I'm using the nomenclature as if you knew what it is. The YJ will be the matrix of inertia of the assembly of variable speed contra moment gyro, this object here, okay? So it's its own matrix of inertia with respect to its principal axis, and as you can imagine, given the symmetry of everything, they are basically ST and J and G. So that's the another matrix of inertia. Then we have gamma, which is the gimbal angle. It's the angle, rotation angle about the g-axis, okay? And then we have omega j, which is the wheel spin rate. It's the RPMs about the s-axis. And then we also have, which is important, the wheel moment of inertia about its spin axis, which is basically part of this yj matrix, but it's important because it's the highest moment of inertia, as you can imagine. It's the one about the spin axis. So we use this in the future. Now, if you're dealing with contra moment gyros, as we will see, they can produce large torques. We said that before. They are torque efficient, power efficient, weight efficient. They take less space than reaction wheel. And I'll leave you with some videos for them. Can't play, seriously. Okay, let me just go into the folder. These videos are actually, you have them. Oh, okay. Well, there's two videos. I don't know why they're not playing, because they used to play just fine. But let me look at this one. So this, can you see the video?
Yes.
Okay. So this is a test bed, kind of similar to what we have in our lab, just much bigger and more expensive. The top part that is moving is basically a spacecraft simulator. It's a structure moving on a spherical air bearing. And these assemblies that you see are contra moment gyros. You don't see the wheels spinning because they are enclosed, but you see they are changing the spin axis. So when you see these objects moving, it's because the gimbal axis is actuated, and there is a control law that is telling them what to do in order to point a certain face of this entire spacecraft in a certain direction. So there's definitely a desired orientation that they are following, or maybe there is a sequence of orientations or a trajectory in terms of orientation angles that they are trying to follow. So that's, you know, some expensive Honeywell CMGs in action. That's what they look like. I don't know why the other one, the single CMG, is not working, but it's basically just one of them sitting on a table and zooming in on that one. Very similar to what you've just seen. So it's been an hour, so I think we're going to stop here because I don't want to impose on your schedule. Any last minute thoughts, questions? Okay, so look at the slides, look at the material that I put on Teams. There is a folder with a bunch of things, including my thesis, and we'll talk more tomorrow, okay?
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Grazie.